Hello everyone, today I'm going to help you get started with Firebase and interact with it from a constraint-free project using JavaScript. Well, for this I'm using Valor Popup JavaScript plugin. This is a very nice plugin for which I'm really thankful. Today's tutorial include initializing Firebase using JavaScript, Firebase authentication, sign up, in and out, Firebase real-time database, and then we'll move on to our C3 editor. I want an app where the user would sign in, then store his or her user score, and then I want to show the first three users on the leaderboard. At last, we will also learn a basic example of database rules for this app.
As given in the web setup of Firebase API, we have to load a few scripts first, then we can call the Firebase functions. We could have loaded files using the HTML script tag with src attribute like in the HTML code here. But as we are using this JS plugin, we can't have HTML codes in our JS file. Let's first see how to create these script tags using JavaScript. Here we are using createElement function on document object to create a script tag and then the src property to assign the src attribute to specify the location address of the file to be loaded. Then we append it under the head tag. These are asynchronous operations. It requires some time to load the file. So what happens in asynchronous operations? At first, our browser sends a request to the server, then the server processes this request and then it makes a response and sends some data back to our browser through the internet. This whole process requires some time. But how do we know when the operation is completed and when to call our required Firebase functions? To solve this problem, one of the solutions is to use a callback function. A callback function is called when another function has been executed. First, we shall have a variable flag which would initially be equal to 0. We have our function initFV. After all scripts loaded and Firebase is initialized, that is, all asynchronous operations are for the initialization are completed, we would assign 1 to flag and make sure that you call the Firebase functions only when flag is 1, otherwise you would get an error. Today I need Firebase auth and database services, so I'll load the following scripts, Firebase app, auth and database. The script 3.onload is triggered when a last script, the script 3, is loaded, and accordingly we will call our callback function. I'll now get the API initialization code all in one line and make another script tag containing this code by using inner HTML property. These are in the init function. This is because unless the scripts are loaded, this Firebase will be undefined. Now set flag equal to 1. In a new file, let's have two objects, auth and db. Under auth, we have errcd to store error code, errmsg to store error message, state to specify whether the user is signed in or not, userid to store current user's UID, and user email to store his or her email address. And under db, we have score to get the user score, S1, S2, S3, and E1, E2, E3 to store the scores and email addresses of the first three users on leaderboard. Actually, I want these values to be shown on the Construct 3V project window. So every tick, I will assign these values to some text boxes on the project window. Introducing Firebase auth functions for sign in and sign up with email and password, sign in with existing Google account, and sign out. Each function returns a promise and this promise can be used to catch errors if any. These are our functions which we would call from construct 3 events for authentication. Sign up and sign in with parameters email and password, sign in Google, and sign out. See, I have set error code to auth.errcd and error message to auth.errmsg. This would be updated when there is an error. Now the next thing we would want to do is how do we know when the user is signed in or signed out? This is necessary because unless you know that the user is signed in, you cannot get the UID and other auth details of the user. We at least need the UID to write data to real-time database at a specified location, different for each user. To solve this, we have to set an observer on the auth object. This observer will always wait until there is any change in auth state, and when there is any change, it will call this callback function. Current user, this is our function to be called through C3 event. If signed in, set auth state to signed in, then we get the current user ID and email. Else if not signed in, set auth state to signed out and set auth user ID and email to nothing. So our authentication is complete. Now we move on to Firebase real-time database. This is how we set values at a specific path in database. The ref function specifies this location. I want to set the current user score at user/UID/score. So I'm assigning auth user ID to a new variable ID and set the address location as user/+ID. Then set this passed value score at node score and user's email at node email. Now you want to read your score from the database. Reference of the location you want to read and use the on function so that every time there is a change in the database data at that location, this callback function is called. Instead, if you use once method, it will trigger only once. I will use on for my project. So I will call this function as soon as the user is signed in only once. I don't need to call the function over and over again. And this is the event type set as value. The value event reads and listens for changes to our database value at the given path. The data we get from this snapshot is a JSON object. To retrieve this data, val method is used. Do note that this tutorial is very much abbreviated, just some basics, and for more information visit the official docs of Firebase. Anyway, over here I'm specifying the path as user/+ID/score. If you directly want to retrieve the value of the snapshot, there will be an error if no such location exists and your Construct 3 game will stop running. So we need to check whether this location exists using exists function, which will return false if there is no such path. If the path exists, then assign snapshot value to db.score. Else call this setVal function with 0 as parameter for the score. Actually, immediately after user signs in for the first time, unless the setVal method is called for the first time, the specified path won't exist. Then we need a leaderboard. To set the leaderboard data, I will copy this setVal function, rename it as setLB and just change this location. This would be leaderboard. You may wonder why I'm using a different location for this. I could have used the same location for users and leaderboard. This is because at users, there could be much more information of the user which you don't want to be read by others. On the other hand, we would allow everyone to read anything on the leaderboard. To read values from the leaderboard, we will need to order them and get the three highest values. For ordering, order by child method is used, which arranges the data in ascending order of the child over here as parameter. I set the child as score. As the data is in ascending order, we shall get the last three data. For this, we use limit to last function with 3 as parameter. For each element of the object in snapshot, another callback function is called. The for each method runs a loop. Set values of child node, email and score to this variable. Let's have a variable I here. When the on function is triggered, set I equal to 0 and inside the for each loop, I will increment the value of I by 1. Now switch I and then set the values of DB object as follows. Remember, the data is arranged in ascending order. This is our increment statement. We have to call this readLB function just after Firebase initialization, and it may happen that no path exists over there. Then the loop will stop executing. To avoid this, I'll add some default values under leaderboard. Set email as empty and score as 0 for each of these MT1, MT2 and MT3 nodes. To the construct 3 editor. On the left pane we have our layout buttons, input fields and text boxes with their names. My email, my user ID and my score reads the corresponding data from the Firebase. Add score and subscore will add and subtract 10 from a global variable respectively, and I will assign this variable to this text box score. Then on clicking button set, that variable would be set to the database. On the right pane, as we can see, is our event sheet. Create a global variable score. This is the current score which is to be sent to the database. Then every tick set that variable to the text box score. Add score and subscore on clicked will add or subtract 10 from the variable score. This all scripts loaded event ensures that all your scripts are loaded. All events related to the JS plugin should be a sub event of this condition. Trigger once, initialize flag with that flag variable in our first script. I'm just changing the cases over here. Then call initfv function. When the initialization is complete, as I had stated earlier, flag would be 1. So the rest of the events would be under this condition, flag equal to 1. Trigger once, initialize these auth and db objects we had in our script. Then call functions current user and readlv over here, as we know that these functions update automatically after being called for once. Every tick assign variables to these text boxes. Set e1 text as db.e1, e2 as db.e2 and so on, auth state as auth.state, error code as auth.errcd, error message as auth.errmsg, my email as auth.useremail, my user ID as auth.userid and my score as db.score. On sign up button clicked, call sign up function with the current text of the text boxes, email and password as the parameters. Similarly, also call sign in with the same parameters and sign out and sign in Google without any parameter. Now when auth state text box is signed in, that is when the user is signed in, call readval function for once. As said earlier, it needs to be called only once. It will be triggered every time the text of auth state becomes signed in. Write a sub event. On set button clicked, if global variable score is greater than text of text box my score, call setval and setlv functions. This will write the values to the database only if the current user is greater than the previous score. Let's set sign in and sign up buttons disabled and sign out button enabled when the user is signed in, and the inverse of this when the user is signed out. Sorry, I did not set the parameters of setval and setlv functions. Set these as variable score. It's time for us now to test our app. When you click sign up with the in-text input fields empty, there is an error. Here you get the information. Now sign up with an email and a password. This text box shows that we are signed in. As I'm not discussing about email verification today, you can use any email ID with any domain name which may or may not exist. I'll set some scores and accordingly the scores and leaderboard will update. You can see when I use different accounts to set the scores, the leaderboard is automatically updated. This is a Firebase console. These are the accounts we created and this is how the database values are stored. Under the rules tab, I'll define new rules to add some security to my app.
On the leaderboard, I will have index on score so that the leaderboard is indexed by the value of score. This reduces the time required for arranging them in order. Now read is true. That is, anyone can read this data. But we do not want anyone to write to some other's data. For this, we need this $UID. This is wildcard location, which is true for any string that is passed to it. We will write values to leaderboard only if $UID is equal to the UID of the current users. Under users node, we want every data to be private. So we will only allow to read or write if $UID is equal to the current user's UID.